Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for standing by. Welcome to this ASM webinar, Fundamentals of Helium Leak Detection. I'm Joanne Miller, editor with ASM International, and we're glad you could join us today. Today's presentation is part of the ASM webinar series designed to provide information you can apply to improve quality, efficiency, and performance. This webinar series supports the needs of our members, customers, and the materials community at large. The series also supports the outreach needs of the leading corporate supporters of ASM and its affiliate societies. The sponsor of today's webinar is Agilent Technologies. Headquartered in Santa Clara, California, with offices throughout the world, Agilent is a leader in life sciences, diagnostics, and applied chemical markets. The company provides laboratories worldwide with instruments, services, consumables, applications, and expertise, enabling customers to gain the insights they seek. Agilent's expertise and trusted collaboration give them the highest confidence in our solutions. The company's 11,000 employees serve customers in more than 100 countries with products and services that make a real difference in the lives of people everywhere. More information can be found online at the address on your screen. We're proud to have Agilent Technologies on board for today's webinar. Before we begin, let me mention a few housekeeping issues. If you're having technical difficulties in joining the GoToWebinar session, dial 866-952-8437. All participants will be in a listen-only mode during the presentation. Feel free to submit written questions at any time by using the Q&A window. We'll answer as many questions as we can at the end of the webinar. We're proud to host today's webinar. For over 100 years, ASM International has served the materials community by providing scientific, engineering, and technical information, as well as education, networking, and professional development. Advanced Materials and Processes is ASM's flagship technical magazine. It provides information about leading-edge developments and trends in engineering materials and the methods used to select, process, fabricate, test, and characterize them. The magazine also covers emerging technologies such as nanotechnology and additive manufacturing and management topics of interest to scientists and engineers. AM&PE News, a bi-weekly publication, delivers updates from the metals and materials industries. Subscribe online today at asminternational.org. With that, I'd like to introduce the speaker of today's webinar, John McLaren. John McLaren is Product Marketing Manager for Leak Detection at Agilent Technologies. John has over 25 years of leak detection experience. Prior to joining Agilent, he was involved in leak detection process development at a major automotive parts supplier. Since joining Agilent in 1995, John has held various sales management, and marketing positions. In his current role, he directs product planning and development, creates specialized application solutions, and assists and trains Agilent's global sales organization. It is a pleasure for me to introduce John.
Thank you very much, Joanne. I appreciate the introduction. I appreciate everyone attending this afternoon and this evening. And without further ado, let's get right into it. I've got a lot of material that I'd like to cover. And I know that some of you may have questions at the end as well. So I'll do my best to leave some time for questions. So for the next 30 or 40 minutes, I'll be presenting some basic information about leak detection, not just helium leak detection, which is what Agilent specializes in, but all manner of leak testing. I'm assuming everyone is here because they're interested in learning about some type of leak that they have to deal with in their product or their process. And, you know, initially we'll talk about the very basic stuff. You know, what is a leak? And I've got a couple of examples here. And, you know, the key thing on both of these examples is they're both giving you a very clear visual indication of where the leak is. And generally speaking, in the world of helium leak detection and in most leak testing applications, that's the problem, is we don't have that visual indication of where a leak is. We only have the result of a problem with our process or product because it's not performing the way that it should. And so we're uncertain where the leak is, and it can be very difficult to find the leak in our system. And so we're trying to prevent something from escaping or from something getting into whatever it is we're working with. So we're trying to locate and, in many cases, measure a leak within a sealed product, within a sealed chamber or device, anything where we're trying to either keep something in or prevent something from escaping out of, whether it be a pipe, a valve, a chamber, a very, very small product. I'll give some examples here in a little bit of the types of things that get leak tested. But in general, this is a quality control test or procedure. We're trying to make sure that whatever it is that we're concerned about has the integrity that it needs, that it's going to perform the way that it should. And obviously, we want to do this in a way that doesn't in any way alter or damage the product. So obviously, we want a non-destructive test. So why do we need leak detection? And, you know, an obvious statement here, anyone who manufactures or uses closed vessels needs leak detection. So anybody who's going to be testing or using something that has to remain sealed is going to require leak testing. And I've got just a handful of examples here. I keep a log of all the different applications that I've had experienced over the years. And I've, as Joanne indicated, I've been in this business for many, many years. And my list is up over 500 different applications. And, you know, hopefully one of these maybe is at least in your general realm of the type of leak testing that you're doing. You know, I like to tell people that, you know, at an elevator speech that we get involved in the cleanest of clean industries to the most dirty, grimy environments that you might be able to imagine. So just listed here are a number of different ways that we leak test products and some examples of those products of where leak testing is used. So as you can see, they range from, you know, individual components to complete systems. Some of these can be extremely large, like in power generation, easily one of the larger things that we leak test is the entire steam cycle on a power plant, because the slightest leak in those systems can cause a very significant decline in their efficiency and in how well they're generating power. There's very, very small devices, like in semiconductor production, where the device itself may only be a few millimeters square, and yet you want to make sure that no air or moisture is able to leak into that product. You know, some examples of industries. I always like to point out cars because everybody's familiar with a car. And what you might not realize is in the car that you're driving, there's over 200 components of that vehicle were leak tested at some point during the manufacturing process. So from brake and refrigeration systems, fuel lines and systems, the lighting and headlights, taillights, that kind of thing, a lot of leak testing goes on. Of course, as you can imagine, even more so is true in aircraft applications. A lot of consumer products get leak tested. So again, places that you maybe never imagined leak testing being used are being checked every single day. So why helium? What is so great about helium? And if you're not familiar with helium leak testing, I'll go through some of these points here. Helium is a very interesting gas, and it's got excellent properties for leak detection. It's totally inert. It's not going to do anything to your process or product. It's not going to affect it in any way. It's non-toxic. It's a very, very small molecule, so it can very easily flow through the types of leaks that we're going to be looking for. It's relatively inexpensive. It's relatively easy to get through industrial gas suppliers. It's at a very low concentration in air, so about 5 parts per million is all. So it's very easy to differentiate a helium leak from the helium background in the environment where you're working. And again, as I indicated earlier, it does allow non-destructive testing. So some of the basic principles of leak detection. The basic reasons that we're going to leak test is we either don't want something that's contained within a vessel to leak out, or we don't want something to leak into that vessel and somehow contaminate or change the process that's going on inside that particular vessel. Regardless of whether it's leaking out or leaking in, any change in either direction of that leak is going to affect our product's performance or our system's performance and the reliability of it. It possibly is going to open up liability issues. Best example of that is in the medical device industry, where obviously anytime you're dealing with medical products, there's the issue of patient safety. And there have been some well-documented instances of products that have failed, products that have leaked, and therefore haven't performed as they should have in a medical application. Implantable devices are a good example, like a heart pacemaker or a cochlear implant. Something that affects all of us would be automotive airbags, and there have been some well-documented instances of airbag inflator problems being caused by leakage into the device and therefore hindering the performance of that airbag or is somehow changing the way that airbag inflator performs. So again, a lot of issues there that come into play with why you want to leak test. And regardless of why, a better product, a product that has a tighter integrity, less leakage, is going to be a better quality product, or the system that doesn't leak is going to have less downtime. And all in all, it's going to reduce our costs, whether that cost is reduced because of less downtime or if it's because of fewer warranty or customer problems down the road because the product doesn't leak. So just a few basic rules with leak detection. And the first one I sometimes find people find a little bit hard to accept, and that is that everything leaks. And you know, a lot of times when I talk to customers and I ask them, what is your specification for leak testing? You know, for the uninitiated, they may say, well, I can't tolerate any leakage. And the fact is, at some level, down to the molecular level, your product will leak. What matters, of course, is how much is it leaking and where is it leaking? So you can find those leaks and fix them or reduce them to a point where they're so small that they're inconsequential. When you test a product, you want to make sure that you test it under the same fashion that that product is going to be used. And it may seem obvious, but in some cases it can be difficult to do that. But ideally, if you have a pressurized device, you want it pressurized when you're leak testing, or if it's going to needs to perform under vacuum, then you need to test it under a vacuum environment and being able to do that at the normal pressures. And the reasons for this should be obvious. A leak may form under pressure, or it may show itself to be larger when it's under pressure, whereas that leak may actually be reduced or disappear completely if it's under vacuum because of things being pulled together, pushed apart, depending on, again, which direction you're testing that product. So you have to make sure you test in the correct direction. Not doing so can give you false results. Now, are you simply measuring the leak or determining, you know, any size of leak? If you're measuring a leak, it can be a more time-consuming process to try to actually measure a leak, whereas if you're simply making a determination, do I have a leak or don't I, and you're not so much concerned about the actual size, it can be a little bit easier to test under pass-fail conditions versus measuring, and that can have an impact then on our cycle time and our response and cleanup times. So, you know, how fast do we need to test? How many leak detectors do we need in order to maintain the production level that we're trying to keep up with? How small a leak are we trying to look for, and are we trying to measure that leak, or do we just want to know, you know, am I above or below some other point in my test? So again, those are all factors that kind of come into play in designing our leak test system. And one last thing I want to talk about here in terms of helium leaks and the size of leaks. I always like to use cubic centimeters per second as a leak rate. There are other leak rate units, torr-liters per second, Pascal cubic meters per second, and that type of thing. But standard cubic centimeters per second are kind of nice in this kind of conversation that we're having, because everyone can sort of visualize what a cubic centimeter looks like. So one cubic centimeter per second means one cubic centimeter of atmospheric pressure and 0 degrees C. That's a standard terminology that's used for those units. And we can sort of visualize what that looks like. So one cubic centimeter of gas in 1 second. That's a leak rate of 1 × 10⁰ standard cubic centimeters per second. And then we get smaller from there, and each order of magnitude you can see that I have listed here is going to be an order magnitude smaller leak. So we go to 10⁻⁰, 1, 2, 3, all the way down to 10⁻¹ⁱ. And then over here on the right column, we're saying, okay, then how long is that going to take to leak that one cubic centimeter of gas? And so now we see, obviously, each time it's going to take an order of magnitude longer to leak that one cubic centimeter of gas. So you can see we get down to extremely small leaks, and it would take us 3,200 years to leak this one cubic centimeter of gas at a leak rate of 1 × 10⁻¹ⁱ. And so, you know, with helium leak detection technology, it's you have the ability of detecting leaks all the way down to this level. There's even specialized equipment that will go beyond that, but by and large, most helium leak detection will go from 10⁻¹ⁱ and larger leaks in being able to detect them. Now, one last thing on sizes of leaks that I'll point out is trying to visualize these leaks can be very difficult. Again, the very first slides we had, those visual leaks were obvious. Helium leaks are not. We can't see helium, we can't smell it, and obviously we're dealing with very, very small amounts. But I'll pick something closer to the middle here, this 1 × 10⁻⁷ leak, which would take 115 days to fill up this one cubic centimeter of gas. And I like to point out to people what that represents in terms of the actual helium that's flowing, because you might envision, if you could shrink yourself down and observe that kind of leak, you might think of it as a, you know, a very, very slow drip coming out of that leak, a slow drip, 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 essentially, of helium molecules. But in reality, that 1 × 10⁻⁷ leak is 27 billion molecules every single second. So it just sort of gives you an idea now of exactly how small helium is, and, you know, again, shows how we're able to detect that. We're talking about quite a few molecules, obviously, but the technology has to be capable of detecting those. And we'll talk a little bit more about the helium technology a little bit later on. First, let's talk about some of the other leak testing technologies. Visual indicators, again, that's where we started this conversation, was things that you can see. And then we get into pressure and vacuum decay and what that can do. Acoustic methods, listening for the leak, because leaks can create a very unique sound. And then tracer gas technologies, which is exactly what helium leak detection is. And there are other gases you can use, halogens, hydrogen, a couple other gases that can be used in tracer gas technology. So visual indicators, these can be special dyes that will penetrate very readily through a leak. They can be other types of reactive liquids. Soap solutions are actually the most common. This probably comes closest to maybe what a lot of people as a kid, you're trying to find a leak in a bicycle tire. So you stick it in a tank of water and you see where the bubbles are coming from. Soap solutions work in pretty much the same way. You spray the solution over the area that you're leak testing and you look for a little bit of foam to form by the escaping gas. So these are all relatively inexpensive methods. Sensitivity is 1 × 10⁻³ at best. It's inexpensive, but it can also be wet and messy and very limited in terms of sensitivity. Pressure decay, in this case, you're simply either creating a pressure or a vacuum, and then you're looking for that pressure to change over time. Again, can be a relatively inexpensive method, but only goes about another order of magnitude better than the soap solution, and can be time consuming because you have to wait for that change to occur and you have to have a device that's capable of measuring that change. Acoustic solutions, they're good because they can find a leak from some distance away. They use specialized microphones to pick up the unique audio signature of a very, very small leak. It's an ultrasonic frequency that the human ear can't hear, but these special microphones can pick it up. As I say, it's good for areas that are hard to reach. You'll see this used sometimes on pressurized gas lines in large industrial facilities. But again, sensitivity is extremely limited, a little bit more expensive technology. And then we start to get into the tracer gas technologies, which again can be a little bit more expensive. However, deliver by far the best sensitivity. Halogen detection is pretty much exclusively limited to the refrigeration industry where those halogens are used and refrigeration systems, air conditioning systems, that type of thing are going to use this type of detector. Hydrogen detection uses a different type of chemical sensor, limited to about 1 × 10⁻⁷. It might be a little fearful hearing hydrogen being used for leak detection. The key thing is understanding that this is used in a mixed gas called forming gas, or often referred to in industry as forming gas. It's 5% hydrogen and 95% nitrogen. So it's non-explosive. It's not a hazardous gas, but it does require that you buy the mixed gas, and it's typically only suitable for a sniffing leak detection application, not for a vacuum application. So that brings us to helium, and that's what we're talking about today. It utilizes a mass spectrometer in detecting very minute amounts of helium, offers by far the most sensitive capability of all leak testing methods. So you're not going to find anything that is able to be superior to helium in terms of the dynamic range and the ultimate sensitivity. And those improvements in range and sensitivity, even though it is a more expensive technology, can offset that cost in terms of how fast we can detect a leak and the speed at which you find it can be much better with helium than they can be with the other technologies. So for production applications or where downtime is an issue and you're trying to establish the integrity of a system and leak test it as quickly as possible, the improvements that helium testing offers over the other methods will make up for that additional cost in capital equipment. So we'll talk about the test methods. I'll go through each of these fairly quickly just to give you an idea of exactly how you leak test and the different ways that you can leak test a product. So there's two what we call outside-in techniques, and this is where you're looking for a leak from the outside of your product or system to the inside. or in a pressurized system where you're doing the inside out. You've got a sealed device and you're looking for something escaping from it. And with inside out, there's three techniques: vacuum, sniffing, and accumulation. And I've got these charts that kind of show in rough form, sort of an example of each one of these. So the outside in using the helium envelope technique. So in this case, we're surrounding the device that we want to leak test, and we're putting a volume around it that we can fill with helium so that you see we've got the helium inside this chamber. And what we're looking for is a leak anywhere on this valve stem, on these valve flanges. We're looking for helium that's leaking in, and then we're creating a vacuum inside the product. And so we're looking for that helium that's leaking into it. So again, the outside in technique. So it'll measure the total leak rate of this system. Doesn't matter if there's one leak or 50 leaks. We'll measure all of them. We'll measure the total leak rate. Obviously, we won't measure individual leaks. We won't know how many there are or where they are. But it's also not operator dependent. We're simply surrounding this with helium, and we're going to create a vacuum. And so we'll see the sum total of helium. And the tooling cost on this type of setup can vary from low to high, depending on exactly how elaborate the system needs to be designed. So the spray technique is very similar. We're still creating a vacuum inside our product or system, and we're sampling the gas with our leak detector that's inside this volume. But now, instead of completely surrounding this device with helium, we're just going to spray at specific locations. So the advantage of doing that, first, we're not going to measure the total leak rate because we're only applying helium at select locations around the part. But it does mean we can identify and measure individual leaks around the part because we know precisely where we're applying helium, and we can then see what the result is on our leak detector. It is operator dependent because in this case, we're going to have an operator operating the spray gun and observing the response on the helium leak detector. So it's important here that the person be trained and be knowledgeable of the process that they're performing. The tooling cost is very low. You simply have a helium supply connected to a specialized spray probe, which then applies the helium around the leak locations, potential leak locations. Now, getting to the inside out applications. In this case, we've got a sealed part here. If the shape looks familiar, then you may have some experience at knowing what a heart pacemaker looks like. This is just sort of the form factor of a particular design of heart pacemaker. And in those applications, the part, when it's manufactured, has helium that is sealed inside of it as a part of the manufacturing process. So there's already helium inside the device. Now, with this vacuum chamber, we're creating a vacuum around the outside of the part. So we're using our leak detector to create the vacuum around the outside, and we want to see if any of this helium inside leaks out of it using our mass spectrometer. So in this case, we're going to be measuring the total leak rate. Could have one leak, could have 50. We're not going to be able to measure or locate individual leaks. We're just looking at the sum total of the leak coming out of this part. So it's the exact opposite of that helium envelope technique that we saw earlier in terms of the direction of the leak. And again, it's not operator dependent. We're simply analyzing all of the gas that happens to be escaping from this particular part, and we're looking for any amount of helium that's coming out of it. It can be a relatively high tooling cost because in order to create this vacuum around your part may require additional vacuum equipment and a specific tooling design in order to build this vacuum chamber around the device that needs to be tested. So the sniffing technique, again, we're going to be putting helium inside our part. In this case, we're doing something a little different. Rather than manufacturing the part and having helium sealed inside it, we make a connection to the part We put helium inside, we pressurize it, and then we use a sniffer probe, which is going to sample a small amount of gas in atmosphere. So we're going to be using this probe. We're not spraying helium this time. We're actually sampling gas. So the gas is going into our probe and to our detector to see if we can detect any of the helium that's leaking from the flanges, fittings, valve stems, et cetera, from our sample part here. So as you kind of get the pattern that we're going through here on what these methods do, obviously we can't measure the total leak rate. We're only going to be looking at identifying specific leak locations as we go around the part. Now, you might think we might be able to measure those leaks. In truth, measuring with a sniffer probe can be, it's an imprecise thing at best, because it depends on exactly where your sniffer probe is in relation to the leak itself. So we always want to be careful. We can't always say, yes, it measures a leak. It can under certain circumstances, but in general, we typically say, no, it doesn't measure the leak, but yes, it does identify where the leak is. And obviously, yes, it's also operator dependent, because again, it depends on the attentiveness and the skill of the person who's handling this probe and observing the response on the leak detector. But obviously a very low tooling cost involved in the sniffer probe and anything else in order to get the helium inside the part. Relatively straightforward and simple. Now, the accumulation technique, this is where actually a couple of techniques come together, and we use a little bit of a couple of different methods here, and allow me to explain. So the accumulation technique is essentially a sniffing technique, but it's an automated way of sniffing. So what we're doing in this case, we see our pipe here with four different flanges. And at each flange, we surround that flange with a piece of tooling that creates a volume, a trapped volume around that flange. In the industry, this is often referred to as a clamshell type flange. It's not a vacuum chamber because there's no vacuum being created. We're simply surrounding the area of a potential leak. And then we want to sample the gas within this volume. So that's what we're doing here with leak with valves that we can open and close in order to examine the atmosphere inside each of these trapped volumes. So we're simply going to sample in sequential order each one of these four different enclosures to see if we can detect an increase in the amount of helium that's present. So you can see here in our second chamber, we do have that increase. Some of the helium that's inside this part has leaked out. So we know in this case that this particular flange out of these four is leaking. This technique's often used in the refrigeration industry, in automotive applications. It's a very quick method of leak detection. And obviously, as you can see, we can do multiple tests in multiple locations, and we can do those all fairly quickly. So when we look at our characteristics here, we can say, yes, we can measure the total leak rate, whether it be the total leak rate from one particular flange, or we can add them up as we go through each one, and we can say, okay, my total leak of all four is this. We can also measure individual leaks. So we know what the leak rate is on each of our four test locations. We can identify the location of the leak, or at least we know which of the four flanges is leaking and which ones are not. We remove the operator dependency from sniffing, because this is all handled in an automated fashion where we're simply looking at each of these four, as I said, in sequential order. And so we take any operator variability out of it, but yet still maintain a relatively low tooling cost, because we're not building vacuum chambers or vacuum systems to check each one of these. So I won't spend much time going over this table. You'll be able to view this program on demand later, but I did put a slide in here just to summarize each of the methods and kind of make a comparison between all of the five methods we discussed and the what you can and can't do with each of those. Now, I should have mentioned back a few slides. We are going to be presenting additional webinars in the future, on particularly on the method of outside in and on large vacuum systems or testing of large volumes. That application in itself has a number of ways that you can do it, and there are some good tips and tricks to learn. So our next webinar will be on leak testing of large vacuum systems, and you'll be seeing more about that in an upcoming email, but that is going to be our next subject. We've done previous webinars and we'll be repeating them again on sealed part leak testing and also on high sensitivity leak testing. So if you do have any questions about our webinar schedule, additional material that we'll be presenting, you're certainly more than welcome to contact us at the email address that you see here and also the email address at the end of the presentation. So just to summarize a little bit about leak detection and what we've covered here in a fairly fast-paced webinar today, again, that everything leaks. And whether you can see the leak or whether you can't, the nice thing about helium leak detection is, you know, we're able to detect extremely minute leaks. We can detect them fairly easily and quickly. We've got specialized software in our instrument that allows you to set it up specifically for your application and make the overall leak test process very easy and take a lot of the guesswork out of how do I set up my instrument and how do I make sure that that this method is going to work for my product or system that I'm testing. Testing it like you use it, as I said, this is probably the biggest key to making sure that your test is done properly and ensuring that you're going to find the leaks that are concerning to you and to your product. To do so in a manner that's not consistent with the way that product is going to be used generally is not going to deliver satisfactory results. You're either going to miss leaks that you would have otherwise found and would have been concerned about, or you're going to waste time because you're going to be creating leaks that wouldn't otherwise exist. So making sure that you test it in the right fashion is critical to making sure that your test works properly. So helium leak detection, you know, we say it offers performance, speed, and flexibility. Those are all true. There are a number of ways that you can use an instrument like this. We've gone through them all fairly quickly. I'd love to hear from anybody today if you have questions, even if it's specific to your own application. I'd like to hear maybe what your experience is, what your problems are, if you have something specific about the product, system, or device that you're trying to leak test. I'd be happy to answer any questions. So feel free to put your answers or put your questions in the chat box. I'll be happy to address those and hopefully can answer your questions. If we run out of time, I'll always be able to respond personally to any questions that you have, or I can always get you in touch with our applications engineers as well if you want to have some in-depth discussions about your leak testing application. And you see here the email address on your screen. So thank you very, very much for listening today. I hope this information has been helpful for you. And let's see if we have any questions from the audience today.
Thank you, John, for that excellent presentation. Before we conclude, we do have a few questions from our participants. So one attendee wants to know, during quality control of a critical tube-to-tube sheet joint, when should sensitive leak testing be performed, before or after hypostatic testing, and why?
Okay. Great question. Generally speaking, and we do have a number of customers that do both hydrostatic testing and helium leak testing. So just for those who aren't familiar, hydrostatic testing just means underwater pressure. Generally, it's better to do the helium leak test first, simply because it's better to not have the water present than to have some residual water present when you do the helium leak test. So we have customers that do it both ways, because sometimes for some reason, or you know, their process dictates that they do hydrostatic testing first. But if I were to make a recommendation, I would say do the helium leak detection first. The water it typically doesn't cause too many problems. Sometimes you'll hear people say, well, the water will plug up leaks. That's can be true to a certain degree, but it doesn't plug up the leak to the helium molecules. The helium is still going to permeate through any residual water that's there, but it's just easier if you do the helium leak testing first and then the hydrostatic testing second.
Okay, good. So another attendee wants to know, what helium purity do you need for positive pressure wand type leak detection? And what helium purity would you need for vacuum type leak detection?
Okay, great questions also. Helium concentration is dictated by primarily by the sensitivity of the leak that you're trying to find. We have customers that use anywhere from 1% to 100% helium. And obviously, if you're using 1% helium, your indicated leak is going to be 1/100th. It's going to be two orders of magnitude smaller than what the leak actually is. So as long as you're aware of that, and as long as that doesn't hinder you from finding the size of leak that you're concerned about, then, as I said, you can really use whatever concentration of helium you want. And obviously, the lower the concentration, the less helium you'll use, the less expensive it is. The one point I want to make that's crucial is if you're using helium, if you're putting helium into a device, especially if you're using a mixture of helium and air, it's always good to evacuate that product and then backfill it with your helium air mixture. Because otherwise, and I've seen this in several different applications, particularly if whatever has helium put into it, if it has a lot of narrow tubing or small recesses and areas that the helium would have a hard time getting to, if you simply try to put helium into that product without evacuating the air that's already there, all you're doing is you're sort of pushing that air out to the far reaches of that product, and it will take much, much longer for the helium to reach that potential leak location. Whereas if you evacuate that air and then backfill it with the mixed gas, you'll instantly get that helium out to all parts of that particular part. So that's the key thing. But whether you're doing wand type sniff testing or vacuum testing, really you can use whatever concentration of helium that you'd like, as long as it allows you to find the size of leak that you're interested in.
Good. Thank you, John. Next question. Helium is becoming scarcer and increasing in price considerably. In fact, this attendee thinks the price has doubled recently. So what have you heard in this regard?
Yes, I've as part of what I do, I stay on top of the helium market. And one thing I want to say to make very, very clear, helium is becoming scarcer, but only in the same way that oil and natural gas and those resources are becoming scarcer. We're using them all, but I remember there was an article in the New York Times, I think close to 20 years ago now, indicating that by 2020, the world would be out of helium. And that was based on some very, very erroneous assumptions when that article was put together. We're nowhere near running out of helium. And so for hundreds of years yet, there's no concern about helium. But it's true, the price has gone up. The price for many years was artificially suppressed by a number of factors and some stockpiling that was going on, and I won't get into all of that. But yes, helium has become more expensive, but it's been relatively stable the last few years. And because of the changes in the marketplace, many gas suppliers are now getting into the helium game, if you will, and they're developing new streams of supply. And so that has greatly stabilized the market. There really aren't any issues of shortages like there were several years ago. So the helium market is very, very stable, and I don't really anticipate any significant changes, problems, or supply issues in the coming years.
That's good to know. Very reassuring. Thank you. How do you define the hermetically sealed device?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question too, because when I say everything leaks, then you could also say that nothing is hermetic. The answer to that question really depends kind of on what it is you're testing, what industry you're in. As you know, I've got some experience going way back in my career to the automotive airbag industry. And in that industry, even within the different types of products, what was considered a good leak rate could vary from one type of product to another. So for example, if your gas inflator was a pyrotechnic device, in other words, it used a solid fuel to create the gas that fills the bag, the leak integrity of that type of product was a couple of orders of magnitude larger than the leak rate specification for a compressed gas type inflator. So even within that industry, you know, what's considered hermetic could vary by a few orders of magnitude. You talk about some of the medical devices that I mentioned earlier, implantable devices, and typically they're being tested to 10 to the minus 9 cubic centimeters per second, if not even smaller than that. So what's considered hermetic will vary depending on what it is you're testing and what industry and what the requirements of that industry are.
Okay, good. Another attendee wants to know, for the outside helium spray technique, what base pressure is required for vacuum, and how does vacuum level inside affect the detected rate?
Okay, all right. A couple of good questions. I'll address them individually here. So the vacuum that's required for the leak detector itself, typically you have to get down to a few torr in terms of the actual pressure inside the system in order for the leak detector to get into its test mode. And so sometimes the leak detector needs some help in terms of an auxiliary pump of reaching that vacuum level. And there are other ways of doing that. It's not absolutely necessary that the system be down to a pressure that low. We've done some tests with restrictive flow devices so that we're essentially, if we're sampling the gas that's being pulled out of that system, so we can keep our leak detector at a lower pressure than the actual inside of the system. But you also lose some sensitivity when you do that type of test. So in general, to answer the question, you know, get down to 10 torr or less, and you know, the system's going to be at a lower pressure, a low enough pressure to use the leak detector. So refresh my memory then on the second part of that question.
How does the vacuum level inside affect the detected rate?
Right. Okay. So the the level of leak that we're able to detect, again, yes, it is dependent on the vacuum level you're able to achieve. So in most instruments, when you're in that range of getting down to a few torr, a few millibar in pressure, and then down to a level of, say, about a couple hundred millitorr or a couple hundred millibar, or 10 to minus 3 millibar, you're able to detect leak rates typically down to about 10 to the minus 7 or 10 to the minus 8 cubic centimeters per second. To get down to smaller leak rates than that, typically you've got to be below that 100 millitorr level. You have to get down to a lower pressure to then get into the minus 9, minus 10, minus 11 leak rates. So, and that can vary from one instrument manufacturer to another. But in general, yes, the lower the vacuum you can get to means the smaller the leak you can detect. And that's just kind of some rough guidelines on where you need to be.
Okay, I'm sure they'll find that very helpful. Another attendee wants to know if you have any recommendations for leak testing small sensors that are welded but not backfilled with helium on assembly. And these sensors are 2 inches high and half an inch in diameter.
Okay. Generally speaking, the way that helium is introduced in those applications is through a technique called bombing. And all bombing is you take those devices, you put them inside a pressure vessel, and you pressurize them with helium. In other words, you're trying to push helium into that device through any leakage that exists. There's a calculation actually that assists with all that. So depending on the size of leak you're trying to find, the pressure at which you bomb the part, and the amount of time that you keep them under that pressure, it's going to dictate how much helium you're able to get into the part, and therefore calculate then what the resulting leak rate coming out of that part will look like. If anyone's interested, again, you can send me an email. I'd be happy to share that calculation, that little spreadsheet with you that does that. But it's fairly easy to do, but bombing, if you've got a sealed device and no other way to get helium into it, then you simply put helium on the outside of it, pressurize it, and you may have to leave it in that condition for several hours, even days, depending on the size of the leak that you're trying to find.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, what type of correlation do you see between hydrostatic testing and helium testing? Is there a disparity? And what is the normal reason for this disparity, if there is one, specifically pertaining to leak testing of welded pressure vessels?
Okay. That's one where I'll have to be honest. I'm not sure if I understand exactly what the intent of the question is. If you're looking for a conversion or an equivalency between a helium leak rate and a hydrostatic test leak rate, off the top of my head, I don't know of one that exists. I do know that typically with hydrostatic testing, you're limited in terms of the ultimate sensitivity, and helium can go far beyond hydrostatic testing in terms of sensitivity, many orders of magnitude in terms of the size of leak that can be found. So I don't know that there's really any correlation there. You know, a lot of times the hydrostatic test is required as an industry or a trade specification or test requirement to prove that the product has not only the leak integrity, but the structural integrity to withstand proper operation. Whereas helium leak testing, even though if you pressurize, you're doing a form of structural integrity test, but really the ultimate goal of helium leak test is simply finding those leaks, identifying where they are and measuring how large they are.
Okay, good enough. This will be our last question, John. And an attendee says, if I have a separate vacuum pump, do I need to isolate the chamber so that only the pump is in the mass spec during the reading? Or can I leave it operating and still get an accurate reading with the mass spec in parallel with the auxiliary pump?
You can definitely leave it running. We have a process called split flow within the detector, which allows you to compensate for that split flow that exists. You're essentially with two different pumps acting on that chamber. Part of your helium signal is being stolen, if you will, by that auxiliary pump. And normally, if you don't take that into account, then that means the helium getting to your detector is going to indicate a smaller leak than what you're actually experiencing. But we have a way to very easily compensate for that and set what that split flow ratio is. Takes a matter of seconds to establish that. And then you can accurately measure the size of the leak on your vessel or chamber simply by calibrating it to a known leak. And then you're measuring, everything you're measuring then on your chamber is going to be exactly the size of that leak.
Okay, thank you very much. And thank you to those who submitted questions. If we didn't get to your question, please know that our presenter will review all of the questions after the presentation. And in a few days, all participants will receive an email with further contact information. I encourage you to complete the brief survey that will appear on your screen as you exit the webinar. With your input, we can continue to provide webinars with high quality, practical information that you can use. I also encourage you to follow up with John for more information on fundamentals of helium leak detection. Once again, I'd like to acknowledge the sponsor of today's webinar, Agilent Technologies. Learn more about how Agilent's products and services can make a measurable difference to your business by visiting their website found on the screen. Thank you again for participating in this ASM webinar. Have a great day, everybody.